Technology Bhopal, welcome you all in 2 days workshop on recent technologies and trends in computer science and information technology organized by Department of Information Technology OIST. We are having 3 very interesting and interactive sessions in this workshop. There will be 2 sessions of 2 hours today and 1 last session will be conducted tomorrow. Now, I would like to invite Professor Atul Barve, Associate Professor and also Coordinator of this workshop, to brief all of us with 2 days program. Atul sir.
Yeah, hello. Good morning, everyone. Respected Mr. Vinod Kotiyaji, respected Director OIST, HOD IT OIST, all faculty members, all my friends, all dear participants, I, Atul Barve, Associate Professor and Coordinator of this FBT, welcome you all in this online FBT on the recent technologies and trends in computer science and information technology. It's an immense pleasure for me to give you a brief introduction about this faculty development program. The aim of the faculty development program is to enrich the knowledge of faculty through interaction with eminent personalities from the industry and academia. The knowledge sharing with improve the teaching learning process to the student and benefit to the society. Predicting the future is hard and risky. Presenting the future in the computer industry is even harder and riskier. Due to dramatic change in the technology and limitless changes in the innovation, only a small fraction of innovations truly disrupt the state of the art. Some of are not practical or cost effective. Some are ahead of their time and are simply do not have a market. There are numerous examples of superior technology that were never adopted because others arrive on time. So in these 2 days, we are trying to cover few of them. Okay. So in these 2 days, we have 3 sessions. At present, we are in first session. So we have with us Mr. Vinod Kotiya. He's a senior IT professional, Bangladesh India Friendship Power Limited Company, NTPC. He's from New Delhi and he will take cloud infrastructure in public sector. In the session 2, we will have with us Mr. Abhishek Jain. He's an associate director in TIA India. He's from Pune and he will take digital consumer experience. On tomorrow, we have a last session from Mr. Abhishek Joshi. He's an architect at MNG Investment, United Kingdom. He will take Azure Basics and Machine Learning using Azure. So in these 2 days, you will learn about these technologies. I wish that you all will attend all the sessions and take benefit of it. Again, on behalf of whole IT department and Oriental Institute of Science and Technology, I welcome you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to introduce you all with our guest and speaker of session 1, Mr. Vinod Kotiya. Mr. Vinod Kotiya is senior manager at Bangladesh India Friendship Power Limited and he have more than 15 years of experience in IT industries. He had worked on various projects which includes cloud-based ERP implementation, enterprise cloud email setup, setting up IT infrastructure at Hydro Greenfield projects, networking and communication setup, IT roadmap and many more. Today, Mr. Vinod will be sharing his knowledge on the topic cloud infrastructure in public sector. Now, I would like to welcome our speaker and request him to start the session. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Neha, and good morning to everyone. I am also thankful to your coordinators, Professor Atul Barve and Professor Swati, and your IT Department of Oriental Institute of Technology for inviting me for such a great program for faculty development. No doubt today everyone is passing through a tough time during this corona crisis. So it's a wonderful opportunity and effort from Oriental team and management for arranging such type of events for knowledge sharing. That's good. I've been told that around 600 people have already registered. So that's quite a good number. Many of you are connected to live stream, so I will not be able to interact one by one, but still I will try to have a collective participation and engagement. So I hope someone from your organization side is doing this monitoring, that people will keep mute during presentation and should not share their own screen. I hope everybody is able to see my presentation screen. So I would like to start the session, and you can ask if you have some query during the session. If it is relevant, I will try to cover up during the session. Otherwise, we can take it up at the last question and answer session. So my topic is, as you can see, the cloud infrastructure in the public sector. So public sector means it is a part of economy which is controlled by the government and its department, which includes departments and enterprises. So there are many departments, central government is having, state governments are having. So these are all make part of public sector, and there are public sector units, PSUs, like NTPC, which where I am working, which deal in electricity power generation. So there are many public sector units are there. So everybody knows about the cloud implementation in private sector. It's quite easy in private sector. It is trending in numerous business like IT, telecom, healthcare sector, hospitality, entertainment, e-commerce. Even universities are adopting. I don't know about how much your college or RGP has adopted this thing, but many more areas to spout in are available. So, but nowadays many public sector units are also adopting cloud due to its varied and efficient features like universal access, cost saving, flexibility, productivity, choice of customization, e-commerce, environmental and economic benefit. So for your participation, I hope all of you are having mobile with yourself. So I would like to get an idea. So you can just open a link on your mobile. It's tiny.cc/rgpv. If you have QR scanner, you can point your mobile camera on this QR code. It will open this questionnaire. I'm again showing you this. Please type this URL on your mobile. tiny.cc/rgpv, or on your browser you can also do it.
Praveen Pandey sir, it's a request. Please mute yourself.
Actually, it gives idea means you belong to which branch. Most of the people have joined from computer science. I think already 200 people have joined. So I expect every one of you can open this link, so that there are so many questions also available during the presentation. So it would be better so that I will have your collective participation through this. Okay, we'll wait for just 30 seconds more, then we will continue. This is the link, tiny.cc/rgpv. So people from other background, non-IT background have also joined. Around 5 participants right now. Okay, so now continue with my presentation. So it's quite a good number, means from non-IT also people have joined. So accordingly, I will continue with my presentation. It gives a fair idea of the participants in a joint venture of NTPC Limited and Bangladesh counterpart. Local power development corporation here. It's a JV. So here I am setting their IT infrastructure from scratch. My interest is also in mountaineering. I am member of Indian Mountaineering Foundation. So this is all about me. Then let's continue to presentation. So first of all, in cloud, when you talk about cloud, then your conversational domain would be like this. You have to use this kind of vocabulary in your day-to-day life when you talk about cloud. So here are some terms like XaaS, where X replaces anything as a service. Actually, it is anything as a service. So you will know later on IaaS, infrastructure as a service, PaaS, platform as a service, like that. There are various cloud model, private, public, hybrid. This thing you should know. Elasticity basically mean with the commissioning and decommissioning of your application or deployment. There is scaling, horizontal, vertical. Demography play role, because cloud is data centers are located at various location. Virtualization means you are getting these virtual machines on over cloud. Vendor lock-in, when you enter into contract with some cloud provider, this kind of issue comes. Vendor lock-in, consumption-based pricing model, it's like a commodity. Then cloud sourcing, how you are going to implement your cloud implementation, subscription. All of you aware of about this thing, subscription, you must be knowing. Multi-tenancy means can be accessed from anywhere through various mode. And there is vertical and horizontal cloud, means how you are going to expand your infrastructure. Vertical, just you are increasing the resources, or horizontal means you are multiplying your server infrastructure. It means that it will be covered up in the presentation. Means this point, these words will be coming up. So this give it, these are the normal terms which are used in cloud. Cloud portability, it is very important in public sector. Means when you are moving from one vendor to another, is it portable or not? Cloud backup, agile infra. Agile means how you are taking up issues of your customer and government need or public requirement, how quickly you are fulfilling it. Then your cloud migration, how you can migrate from your standard in-house infrastructure to cloud. Cloud storming, when you go for many cloud technologies at once, it is known as cloud storming. Then cloud broker and integrator, you need to take help of system integrator when you're going for cloud. Then SLAs, it's service level agreement to operate your cloud infrastructure. Then there comes six cloud providers, which provide the services related to cloud. So before going for cloud, first you need to understand this traditional IT infrastructure. So what happens basically in the traditional IT infrastructure, you are having all your IT infrastructure in house in a building, like all your servers will be kept in a data center. Okay, so many servers will be available, like mail server for your email services, if it is your university or college or an enterprise. So that corporate mail server will be there. Then web server for hosting your all the web application, like your college website, or then payment gateway, or front end applications for students. And then FTP servers are being used for your file sharing. Then database repository must be there. Then you have to look for your power supply need, building infrastructure power supply, also redundant power supply. Your source power sources should be coming from multiple UPS, so that availability of your data center should be around 100%. Then there there will be your to access this data center, you will be having your local LAN infrastructure, where your client machines will be available, which students, faculty, all these people are outside of your university or college, people will be accessing through internet. So when it comes to internet, then firewall comes into the picture, that you also need to own that firewall. Then you have to set up some demilitarized zone to prevent some cyber attacks. Then you have to provide facilities for your maintenance engineers, all this. So it gives a traditional IT infrastructure picture. Almost all traditional IT infrastructure is similar to this. So this is your traditional IT infrastructure. So when you understand how this traditional IT infrastructure works, then it will be very easy for working in the cloud. So now to understand about cloud, I will please come again to your mobile. Okay, mostly many of people have not worked on the cloud platform. It gives a fair picture that almost 80% have not worked on the cloud platform. So I'm moving to next question. Check your mobile. So the term cloud in cloud computing represent what? Okay, hard disk first. So around 30 plus participants are saying internet, then hard disk 50%. Again, 50% of hard disk they are saying wireless. Okay, so correct answer is internet. Okay, cloud in the cloud computing represent internet basically. So I'm stopping this presentation. We'll continue the presentation. So what happens in cloud? When you know this traditional IT infrastructure, because it is in-house, even you don't need internet to access your on-premises IT infrastructure. There are two terms we normally use: on-premises and off-premises. When you it comes to IT infrastructure, on-premises means it is within your building, or in your university building, college building, or in your office. Then off-premises means it will be outside your building. So when it becomes off-premises, then you don't have any option other than get it connected through internet or some dedicated leased circuit provided by ISPs. So when you comes to cloud, all the infrastructure is same. You will be having your data center servers, okay? Then your OS is not like traditional IT infrastructure. Even in traditional IT infrastructure, we use this virtual OS. Same thing is available in cloud. So mostly it is complete virtual OS. Then there are software platforms available. Then application will be available, and then storage and data will be available. So this cloud term is used for internet, not for hard disk. Hard disk is just a hardware. Hard disk is there in your local IT infrastructure also, and cloud. Okay, so these are the resources, part of resources in your traditional IT infrastructure and cloud IT infrastructure. So there will be storage, data, everything. So Now, what changes is there only? Only thing is that now we have moved all this infrastructure to the internet or a dedicated network, which you only you can access basically. So now it is said as cloud. So this term refers basically internet. So how it can be accessed? As you can see in this picture, you need to connect it through router to internet, and then you can access your cloud resources, whatever server, email, desktop, operating system, software application, or database, anything you can access through cloud. So this is the design of cloud infrastructure. Now, when you go for cloud infrastructure, there are some models available. These are called cloud service model. I told that term XaaS. So X is for anything. So we have used for these three things: SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. So what happens? SaaS, it is software as a service. What happens here? Software is licensed on a subscription basis and is centrally hosted. You don't own the software. You are just subscribing. Examples are email, Office Suite, ERP, CRM software. ERP is enterprise resource planning software, which you use for digitalization of your business process of your enterprise. CRM, your customer relationship management software. So this is SaaS. Then comes to PaaS. What happens here? You don't go to software level. You are taking a platform to develop your own application. You manage that application without the need of infrastructure. So it's called PaaS. Then here some example databases, application server, web server, DevOps. DevOps is the new term, which means traditional software developer will get surprised. Normally what happens is software developer develops the software and hand it over to the operation team, and it takes so much time. But nowadays, both of these things are getting merged, development and operation. So it is a DevOps. Then provision processing in infrastructure as a service. Provision means what kind of infrastructure you want, basically. What kind of computing resources you want, storage requirement, networking requirement. All these things you can provision in the infrastructure as a service. So here comes virtual machines, storage, backup, and networking. So this three model simplifies as consume, build on it, and migrate to it. So SaaS, you just consume, it's available for you. Then PaaS, you have to build there, and infrastructure service, you migrate there. So again, come to your mobile. Mostly everybody has clear idea. Still 4-3. Okay, so Microsoft Office is a software which is hosted on cloud by Microsoft. So now you don't need to install it. Even I made this presentation on this Microsoft Office 365 without installing any Office software. So it is available on cloud. You can subscribe it. You need to pay through your credit card, and it will be available to you. So it is a software as a service. Now come to next question. What is Netflix? Okay, these are the SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. What is Netflix? Check your mobile. That question is coming there. Answer it. What is Netflix? Netflix is also a platform. Okay, it's a platform. What platform? It is an entertainment platform, but it is running as a software service because you subscribe it. Yes, so it comes under SaaS. So mostly people have answered PaaS, maybe due to some confusion. So it's a subscription. It's a subscription to consumer because you take the subscription, you pay some subscription fee, and then you are able to access through web browser. It's an application for the end user. So whenever these applications come, all are software. It's not a platform. Okay, so this is a software as a service, you are consuming it basically. You are paying and you are watching movies and web series on it. So it's like that. So it will be SaaS. Now come to examples. Okay, now many of you have used this Gmail app. It is also, it comes under SaaS. Google apps, so many Google apps are there. And then here is Google Docs, Google Sheet, you can create your Google Map. Then BigCommerce, Salesforce, Dropbox, it is used for file storage, MailChimp, Zendesk, it is CRM software, DocuSign, it is for contract management, Slack, it's like an alternate of email. In your organization, you can chat and execute your day-to-day work. HubSpot, these are products, many products like even Uber or Ola, these are applications which are available to, these are example of SaaS. Then under PaaS, platform as a service, all these major cloud service provider are giving their platform. So if you want to develop your application in .NET, PHP, Java, whatever, you can go for PaaS, because you are going to develop, you are not going to use or subscribe any application, you are going to develop your own website, something like that. So then you will go for PaaS. So it will become platform as a service, because you will get a platform. You don't need to think about what is underlying infrastructure there, what kind of RAM or CPUs are there. You will be availing a platform just, and you will start developing your code directly. So these are the technologies, these are the marketing name, but you need to understand the concept is same for all this. If it is AWS Elastic Beanstalk, if you talk about Heroku is also used to host your application on cloud. Then Windows Azure, mostly used as PaaS, it has .NET framework in which you can easily create .NET application and websites on this Windows Azure platform. Force.com, OpenShift, these are the competitor of this major cloud provider, like Google, AWS, and Windows. They are having their own cloud infrastructure. They are having their own cloud technologies available with them. Then OpenShift, Apache Stratos, Magneto, Commerce Cloud. All of these are similar in nature. Then infrastructure as a service example is AWS EC2. This is for getting the instance of your virtual machine. So when you subscribe for AWS, then you can choose your infrastructure, what kind of infrastructure you want, how much RAM, how much CPU processing power, how much storage space. That kind of thing can be defined on infrastructure as a service. And these are the products and companies which provide this kind of services. Then Rackspace is another company. Google Compute Engine, it's very popular nowadays. It takes very less time to host a server. Within 1 minute or 2 minutes, you can start your server running. DigitalOcean, Magneto One Enterprise Edition, these are the companies. They are having their own proprietary operating system, software, application tools, development stack. All these things are available with them, but concept is same. They provide this service, means they will provide you infrastructure, CPU, RAM, storage. That is your infrastructure. Even networking, public IP, firewall, subnetting, virtual LAN you can create within the server environment. All these things comes under infrastructure. So these are the example of those things. Then it will give a clear picture. What is the difference between traditional versus cloud? So all of you know traditional IT. What is the traditional IT which you do in house? You are having a room, server room. There you put your data center, servers, and networking equipment, storage. You do some virtualization also. Sometimes you are having independent server for different operating system, Linux, Windows, anything. But sometimes in single server, you are having multiple operating system. For that, you are using virtualization. When operating system comes, then middleware. Middleware is the layer between your operating system and application. It's like REST API or some web services. Then it comes runtime engine like .NET framework or Java runtime kind of thing, and then data and then application. So all this thing in traditional IT, you are the owner. You plan all this thing, what you want, how your data center will look, how networking will be done, how much storage you want, how many servers, what kind of operating system, what kind of application development platform. You can do make a website on .NET also, you can make a website on PHP. So it's upon you what you want. Everything is managed by you basically. Database you choose, MS SQL you want, or MySQL you want, Oracle, whatever database that you decide. As per this, you make application which is available to your end users. So this is the traditional IT infrastructure. But when you move to cloud, now you will have choices. You have three kind of choice, as I already told. Infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. So in infrastructure as a service, or you come first to software as a service, you don't need to do anything. You see, you don't need to manage anything. This is tech, when you see, application data runtime middleware, you are not concerned about. When you use Netflix, you are not concerned what type of application data runtime or networking is there. You just open your browser or app and you start using Netflix. You start using your Gmail. So this is the software as a service model. Then comes this platform as a service. In platform as a service, you have to make your own application basically. You are designing your own application for your own requirement of your end user. So you just need the infrastructure. So you hire that infrastructure like runtime middleware operating system. All this thing will be available to you with as a service from the service cloud service provider that you can buy. Platform as a service. Now you need to only develop, focus on application and data part. Now come to infrastructure as a service. In this, you need to manage something more. Means sometimes based on your requirement, you need to choose your own operating system, your own runtime platform, all these things. Then this infrastructure as a service comes. So normally it happens for big application like ERP and some CRM kind of application. So like for SAP, you should have fixed kind of infrastructure, CPU uses and this RAM requirement. So this thing will come in infrastructure as a service. I think it's clear. It's very easy, and now it will be very clear to you using this thing. So now you can understand the difference between traditional versus cloud. So in traditional, everything you have to perform, and in cloud, your liability decreases basically. So if some software, email software is available, like Gmail software is available in a cloud, then why you are putting your effort in hosting one local email system in your data center? You need to give power, manpower, and technical skills will be required. So that decision you need to take. So people decide based on this three major service model, service delivery model. So how it affects traditional versus cloud? What happens now? Utilization of IT resources is a major point. In traditional IT, your resources are used very low. What you do, you create a data center, you put a web server there, and then you make a website, suppose for your students front end, your college students can use it. So how frequently they will use? Hardly 5% utilization will be there. It will spike when some admission is happening, payment, or for exam fee students are paying, then only they will accessing your website, and then load will increase. So around 99% of the time, you are not using your resources fully in the traditional IT. But in cloud, it is optimum. It's on demand. That can be achieved in cloud only. Then procurement cycle is very long. You have to plan everything. You need to put budget, and then you go for procurement, tendering, and after all this thing, then you set up your traditional IT infrastructure. But in cloud, it is again quick. As I told you, in Google Cloud environment, you can start running your server within 1 or 2 minutes. Then capital outlay for hardware and application, that you have to keep, means your capex budget will always be there. But in cloud, it's not required. Flexible IT infrastructure. Obviously, in traditional IT, you will not be flexible. But in cloud, you can try many things. Built-in scalability, international IT, it will not be available. So in simple case, if your demand increases, so this sometimes you hear about this website collapse during this when results comes out. So all these things happen because you can't scale your hardware infrastructure or server infrastructure in a short time. So that is not possible in traditional IT. Then maintenance is an issue. You have to manage your own infrastructure locally. You have to depute some manpower engineers to manage your IT hardware. Then focus on this cloud. You need to focus on your users, not the maintenance, because your service provider is doing the maintenance and all this thing. Then pricing model is fixed. Cloud, it varies because as per service, you need to pay. Technology obsolescence. This is the thing which all public sector are facing, because normally server, hardware, everything is procured for 5-6 years. So, and in IT, technology moves very fast. And even applications, new applications are coming every 6 months. So it's very difficult to keep pace with technology in case of traditional IT infrastructure. But in cloud, everything will be available with cloud service provider, and you just need to subscribe it. These are the cloud characteristics, means how you will identify the cloud. So basically, this is a on-demand self-service. You need to demand what you want, and the cloud service providers are ready with all kind of services. Amazon is having huge service stack with them, like then again, broad network access, all kind of access is available to you through VPN, through network, through leased circuit, rapid elasticity. Rapidly you can deploy any service, decommission any service, anything you can do. Resource pooling is available. In cloud, you can resource your network, your database, your application, your server hardware. These all comes under resources. That pooling you can do, how you are going to utilize your resources between your different application. Measured service, it is measured service, means how much, whatever you are going to use, you need to pay only for that part. So if you have, you are taking some hard disk space, like in case of Google Drive, you are buying 30 GB, so you can use 30 GB, you paid for that much. If you are going for 1 TB, you need to pay for that much. So this is measured basically. Then virtualization. Virtualization is there. It is in the core of this cloud actually. You can create many virtual machines. Then it is geographically distributed. Data centers are located all over the world, and you can choose your data center as per geographic location. So when you understand the service delivery model of cloud, so that affects only your requirement, basically what type of cloud requirement you are having. But when you go for using the cloud, you can choose deployment model. There are basically three deployment models available: public cloud, virtual private cloud, and government community cloud. Normally in textbook, so many deployment models are available, like hybrid cloud, and here I'm telling virtual private cloud because it is a logical separation in public cloud. It is a part of public cloud actually. So this three type of cloud models are available. So what happens in public cloud? In cloud infrastructure is provisioned for open use by the general public. Means public will decide what kind of cloud infrastructure they want to use. Means you can decide Netflix you want, or Hotstar you want, or which kind of email service you want. You can choose. You have the choices available. So mostly you must be using some kind of cloud product. There are so many cloud products which I already told you. So in software as a service, G Suite, Microsoft 365, Dropbox, it's are available. Then platform as a service, Google App Engine, Heroku. Then infrastructure service, all these things I already told. So this is the public cloud. All this public, just Google and Amazon are providing. These are the public cloud. It can be owned by anyone. Basically, you need to subscribe it. But one thing is there, all the infrastructure, hardware infrastructure will be available with the service provider. Means Google or Amazon will be having all these things. It will be open to everyone. Services can be available only through internet. So all you need is just a web browser or your mobile marketplace to download the app, and you can avail the service of public cloud. So the big cloud provider like Amazon and Microsoft have huge pools of computing resources powering their public cloud services. This has to massively benefit you, basically. Firstly, it means you can take advantage of economy of scale. The cost of a large network is split between many people. So they have put huge computing resources, and now they are giving these resources on subscription. They have commodity five, basically. Like electricity, you are paying bill for your home. So large power generating plants are generating electricity, and now it is available to you. So you don't need to generate your own electricity. It is like that. So they have commodified all the this resources. So the resources are so huge that the services are very fast. You will be very happy with your Gmail service, or like we are using this Google Meet platform. I think suppose your university or college have set up this in-house video conference system, then so much of effort was required for managing this meeting session actually. So this is the benefit of public cloud actually. So capital overhead and operational cost drop for individual user. You are just paying for what you are using. Many cloud providers even let you have a certain amount of cloud access for free. Even they are providing services for free. Gmail is free for so many years, up to 15 GB you can use. After that, you need to pay. Secondly, it means you have access to essentially unlimited computing resources. Suddenly, if your website had 100 times spike, that you can manage in public cloud easily. You need to just augment your resource. The other key advantage of public cloud is the location independence and ease of use. You don't need to worry about where you are, because you are connected through internet. You can set up your hardware, network setting, anything from anywhere. Okay, it's just like plug and play for what you use as you use it. Businesses of all size are using the public cloud for web application, document collaboration, webmail, and storage of non-sensitive data. So these are the reason why businesses are using. Now if you see for the pros, it's low price. Sometimes it is very free. It's scalable. You can scale it as per your requirement, location from anywhere you can access, and it's very easy and very convenient to use. Then some issues comes, which is the security of your data, the law applicable law in which country server is residing, the law will be applicable as per that, and location of your data, lack of control, you don't have control of your data. You can only access the service and use it. Customization will not be available. Whatever product is there as such, you have to use it. So this is the public cloud. I hope it clarifies what is the public cloud. All the services which already you are using resides on public cloud, which is accessible through your mobile, internet, or browser. Then comes to private cloud. So what happens here in the cloud infrastructure is provisioned by exclusive use by a single organization comprising multiple customers, like business unit, like my enterprise, suppose NTPC Limited, they can have on private cloud, and which shall be accessible by all the smaller units, all my plants, like that. It can be on or off premises. So in public cloud, it will always be off premises. You are using the infrastructure of a cloud service provider. But in private cloud, you can have in-house infrastructure as well as service infrastructure of your service provider. Okay. I think somebody else is presenting. Please don't share your presentation. So,
guys, it's my humble request. Please don't share your presentation.
So, so private cloud is a popular cloud deployment that addresses some of the main issues with using public cloud. So whatever issues which are coming in public cloud, it addresses those. As you can probably guess, the private cloud deployment model has a key difference to public cloud. It is privately used by a single organization and not open to the public. Only organization can use this cloud, unlike public. It is also sometimes called internal cloud or corporate cloud or enterprise cloud. For example, a large insurance company or any other company needs a lot of computing resource for many different parts of the company, country-wide operation. They are having so many offices. So they can have a private cloud at a centralized location and all the offices can access it. So the risk assessment team needs, there are issues of security also. So that can be handled in this private cloud. Then due to security reason, each department or user, they will have identity management, means proper authorization and access to use this private cloud. So private cloud is you don't need to rely on public service provider for setting up your own private cloud. If companies are setting up their own private cloud, there are technologies available. Like OpenStack is such technology, means you can create your own private cloud. So some of the biggest providers here are HP, VMware, Dell, Oracle, IBM, Microsoft, and Amazon Web Services. So what you have to do, you just need to approach this service provider and then they can set up a private cloud for you. So this is the pros, control over cloud setup, means you are having full control of your cloud setup because it is designed as per your requirement. It is not like public cloud. Control over privacy and security. You are setting up policies for your security and privacy. Control over the demography of data. Like basic need of public sector is that all of the data should be residing in India. So we can tell the service provider that whatever data center you are setting up, it should be within India in case of off-premises. But when you are going for on-premises, then you will give space in your office building or university building to set up the private cloud. Then there are some disadvantages. It has higher setup cost. You need to pay for setting up your own infrastructure, basically. It is just like a traditional IT infrastructure, but you are not going to manage it. You are outsourcing your management to a service provider. That's why it is not different than your traditional setup. It has less redundancy. Then scalability will also be less because everything is defined. Then you need your own expert team to manage each and every stake of this cloud services. Now comes to community cloud. So this cloud infrastructure is provisioned for exclusive use by a specific community of consumer from organizations that have shared concern. Like when it comes to public sector or government, so they can use same kind of services using community cloud. So if government is setting a community cloud, then it will be shared within different department or their units or district administration like that. So it will become a community cloud. It is like a private cloud, but in private cloud only single entity is using it. But in community cloud, multiple entities are involved, which are of same nature. So it will not be like if government has set up a community cloud, then some private companies also using that service. So it will not be possible on community cloud. And few examples are Meghraj. Meghraj, I don't know if any of most of you should know this. This Meghraj is the Government of India initiative for cloud implementation. One more thing, there is a term in textbook, hybrid cloud. So don't need to mix it up with hybrid cloud. Hybrid cloud is different. When you merge any of these three cloud, public, private, or community, then it becomes hybrid actually. It looks like hybrid, but it is not a hybrid cloud, because same nature of organization are using it. Then it is not different than public cloud. Everything is defined. Who is going to use it and in which manner they are going to use it. Security requirement is properly taken care. So that is the advantage. So total control I'm already having like private cloud. Then total control I'm having like similar to private on privacy and security. But it is cheaper than private cloud. This cheaper or costly depends only on your users basically. When you go for public cloud, so many users are there. That's why it is very cheaper. But private cloud is very costly. But in case of public cloud, since many organizations of same nature are involved, so it is a little bit cheaper than private cloud. It is more scalable than private cloud, because infrastructure will also be used similar to public cloud. Then it is in between, as I said, it lies between public and private. So you will not get any full benefit of both. Now come to your mobile once again. In all this cloud deployment model, which is having more financial accounting and auditing issues, which is having? Means where you need to put extra effort on your financial accounting and financial auditing in all of this? Okay, 10 seconds more. Participation is very less in this mobile questionnaire. Only 200 people have joined. 30, 40, 50, 60, around 60, 70 are replying. Okay, so when you see financial accounting auditing issues, it is very easy in traditional IT. Actually, everything is defined. My budget is defined already. I know how much expenditure I am going to do in my public sector. Okay, so as per that, I am setting up my IT infrastructure. I have purchased my server, infrastructure, everything. So there is no such issues on my financial accounting and auditing. When you go for private cloud, since it is similar to traditional IT, so again, same thing will happen. Everything is defined. Then what happens in public cloud? Here, everything is on demand, subscription based, okay, scalable, so much flexibility is available. So here trouble starts in public cloud. So what happens, I need to put extra effort for financial accounting. Even if you subscribe some service for 1 year, then financial year will be overlapping. Such kind of things will happen. And auditing means you are not going to keep track of what kind of service you have rendered or not, or you have been charged for which service. If you are completely going for cloud, because hundreds of services are available on public cloud. So major pain is in the public cloud. I hope you understand what I mean by showing this thing. So when you are working on traditional and private cloud, then you are very comfortable. That is the main reason public sector is reluctant to move for public cloud, because it will be very difficult for doing all this thing. It will come as a pain. You have to put extra effort for doing all this thing. Community cloud will also be defined somewhat, because it lies between private and public. So public cloud demand more effort. Okay. So come to the slide. So when you go to the market as a private entity, then you are having so many options available from major cloud service provider players. One is the Google. So when you see the technology stack they are having, compute engines they are computing they are providing, compute engines, Kubernetes, it's very good containerized or Docker kind of thing. Then App Engine, Cloud Functions. Cloud Function is suppose you are having only requirement to run a single function, then you don't need to buy any infrastructure platform OS. You can just take subscription of this cloud function and you run your function, like sending email to all your students, like that. So such kind of function you want to implement. So at that level you can do this, and whatever time you are going to use it, you need to pay only for that much. Then management you can do. Consoles are available, logging, debugger, monitoring. Then when you come to networking, they are having good this load balancers available. So they can distribute the load properly on your application as per the demand. Then CDNs are available, cloud CDN, content delivery network, means when you are having streaming or some content delivery, then it is distributed in their various server. Localized server, so that content can be delivered easily to the end user. Then cloud DNS firewall rules. It is a part of networking. They are providing VPN service also. If you want more security, then you can connect to your network through this virtual private network. Then it comes to storage and database. They are having in their unique kind of database. It's not relational database. They are having one cloud SQL also, relational database. Other are non-SQL. They are. It is for storing big data. So they are having cloud big table data store. Then in big data, they are having BigQuery and all this technology available for IoT and machine learning, data analytics, it is used there. Then for identity and security, they are having their own technology stack available for this identity and security. In machine learning, they are providing all such kind of services, cloud vision API, EMC. Already API is ready for identifying the video feed or image feed, that then it gives the results. So you just need to subscribe it, everything is readily available and you can use it. But you have to learn that technology stack. Basically, if you are going for this Google, then you have to get training for in all this thing. When it comes to AWS is having more than 200 services like Google also. So in, this is the area where they are providing in compute engine. They are having container system. They are already having databases, development tool, IoT, machine learning. Similarly, they are also having so many services available with them. When it comes to Microsoft Azure, so they are also having similar kind of technology stack available for cloud. Compute, they are having this cloud services, remote application, web application. In web and mobile, they are having web application. Their .NET framework is very strong with this Visual Studio, Azure SDK. So whatever you develop, you can deploy very easily on this .NET framework on their cloud. It is very useful for people who are already working in the .NET technologies. Then integration with other services, their machine learning, data analytics, AI tools, all these things are available. So again, you need to train yourself. These all are different technologies compared to Amazon and Google. So you have to relearn, basically. So it is recommended, basically, you need to choose any one. If you want, it is very difficult to expertise in all these three technologies, three different service providers technologies. They are in their own content delivery network. So all are similar thing. Basically, they are providing services and they branded it. It is marketing gimmick, basically. But all Stack is doing same kind of job, which we have discussed how this cloud service model is deployed. So how this cloud is beneficial? Suppose even for entrepreneurs, suppose 3-4 people you want to start a company. So it's very easy for all of you to make your IT infrastructure similar to some enterprise. It's very easy. Means when you see, you can have your corporate email system like from G Suite or Office 365. It just cost only $5 per month, okay, and you will get all your this video call feature, collaboration to Google Sheets. Finally, you can work on presentation. All these tools you are getting. Since you are having your small company and no IT infrastructure, but still you are enjoying all this service in such a cost. Then you can host your website on cloud. And take your domain name, it comes under only $20 to $100. Then mobile app development, it's very easy. Earlier people used to develop app on this Android Studio and such kind of thing. Now everything is available on cloud. When you go for App Inventor, which is the project of MIT, here simply by dragging, dropping, and without coding, basically you can develop mobile apps. So this Codular is the same framework. It is forked from this MIT App Inventor. So this Codular is also there. So almost free of charge, you can develop your mobile app and deploy on the Play Stores. Then HRMS cloud solutions are available. Means for your day-to-day HR activity, you can subscribe for solutions which are available in the market. That also sometimes they are free, and it comes up to $5 per month. Accounting solutions are available on subscription basis. Then if you want to buy a simple server on Google Cloud, it comes around $50 per month with basic server, minimum CPU or RAM requirement. Then marketing platform like MailChimp, it is almost free. So now you will have enterprise-like infrastructure with the help of cloud. So what is the benefit if your startup moves ahead in future, your employee strength increases or your customer base increases, then you can easily scale up. Scale up is very easily. Just you need to pay for scaling up, and you will be still having a great IT infrastructure. So this is how cloud is helpful for entrepreneurs also. So scenario to adopt cloud for public sector. Public sector can means all this government or government departments and public sector enterprises, they can adopt the cloud in following manner. One is that this development and testing environment. Suppose they are so much concerned about their data, and normally they don't go directly to the cloud. They want to keep their data safe inside the wall. So what they have to do first, they can go for they can subscribe for development services. They can put their application on the cloud. They can test, and when it comes to deployment, they can host it to their in-house or traditional IT infrastructure. Then storage, they can take some data which is generating in huge like revenue records, land revenue records, or in my case in NTPC, or machines generate so much of data that can be stored on the cloud. Then disaster recovery. They can move for disaster recovery. They can take keep backup of their sensitive data on the cloud with proper encryption. Then big data analytics is only possible in cloud. So it's a very huge task if somebody is thinking that they will do it in-house in their traditional IT infrastructure. So that is the major thing, big data analytics. If you want to have in future, then you have to must go to cloud, because all the APIs and services, everything will be available on the cloud only. It is not possible in your traditional IT infrastructure. Then ERP application is the last stage, which can be adopted for the cloud. In ERP means all your business process mapped online for or day-to-day transaction. So many ERP applications are available. SAP is the leader in this field. Oracle is also having, Microsoft is also having. So this is the cloud adaptation strategy for government sector. So quick things which are for cloud adoption. One is that applications having seasonal or cyclic requirement. Like in education department, whenever this admission starts or exams are happening, this then only some requirement comes. So it's better for them putting their infrastructure on the cloud. Then test and development environment, because there is no risk or any issue. It will be very easy to do the testing and development on the cloud. Then application requiring centralized architecture, centralized schemes of government, like this NSP portal, I think it is for a scholarship, then your Mudra Yojana or all other such kind of now PM told for this Russian card, centralized Russian card for the nation. So all those things can be go to cloud. Low to medium uses of bandwidth requirement. If your bandwidth requirement is minimal, then you can go. All smart city IoT data is going on cloud. Then application having varying data retention requirement. Suppose you have to keep your data. Normally in government sector, there are policies to keep retain the data for few years. Somewhere it's 15 years, somewhere it's 7 years, 5 years, like that. Then those things can be safely kept on cloud. Then careful assessment is required only for this scenarios where data is very top secret, you know, for defense or such kind of ministries. Then if highly decentralized architecture means your architecture is very complex, like in all big public sector like NTPC, ONGC, we are having very decentralized architecture, different applications, so it's very difficult to go for cloud. Then application which runs on perpetual basis. Whenever requirement comes, then only we are using it. Then any regulatory licensing requirement, sometimes the government policies are there. Such kind of data should not reside on cloud. In those cases, we have to do the assessment. Then cloud access is also come into account when you go for cloud adoption. You have to see how means end user is going to access your services, cloud services. So if it is citizen-facing portals, then it is better you should go for cloud. Don't put your infrastructure in-house when general public is going to use it. So access, they can easily. I think my presentation. Presentation was stopped. Okay, so what I was saying, citizen-facing portals, so that people can access it on mobile device. Suppose this electricity department, they have to send electricity bills. All such kind of things should be hosted on cloud. So it will be very easy and scalable, so that good services are available to the citizens. Then secured applications. So when it comes to secured applications, then you don't need to give access through internet. You are having this virtual private network, point-to-point connectivity, leased circuits are available, and PLS's technology is there, so that only dedicated line will be available for certain end users, then which they can access. Then air gap system means no access through internet, not at all, means it will not be available on internet. So one van wide area network will be set up, and through this all the applications can be accept. But all the applications will be available in the cloud, in any cloud, public, private, or government community cloud. Then it, one difficult thing comes in the public sector is the legacy applications, means already application which has been developed over the years, means last 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. All these applications running in the government department, even if you see in the bank or railways, na, you see they are having old applications still running, old hardware framework, operating system framework, your database framework, and these applications are very old. So that is the main hindrance. So for them to come to cloud. So what we need to do for this thing, you have to adopt some cloud migration approaches so that your legacy application, which is already running, can come to cloud. So for that, one thing is the recourse on infrastructure as a service. You will take the infrastructure and redeploy an application component to another physical, virtual or cloud infrastructure without recompiling, altering the application code or modifying feature and function. So I will take the virtual machines and server and completely, I will set up the same operating system and runtime environment for my application and I host there. So in this way I can migrate my legacy app. Then there is one option, replace with SaaS, means what I will do, I will look for the similar alternative available in the cloud. So it is best, so example is your email system. Already so many mail server, in-house mail server, government departments are using local mail server. So if some good mail services are available, like Office 365, Google Suite, such kind of email services are there, then I can directly replace. I can create new, I can shift my domain to this cloud service provider and I can completely replace my legacy app. So this is the example of replace. Then encapsulate data and functions in the application and make them available as services via an API. So I will take the important data and function which my application is performing and put on the cloud and I can access it through application programming interface, API. Then replatform. What I have to do, migrate an application component to a new runtime platform. I need to change my platform. Suppose some application is running on Linux PHP based, then I will redevelop or redesign it on .NET and host and Windows environment, something like that I have to do. Then refactor for PaaS, restructure and optimize existing code without changing its external behavior. So behavior of application will be same. I need to restructure and optimize it so that its components, feature and structure will improve. Then re-architect. So materially alter the application code so you can shift it to a new application architecture. I will completely move to the complete a new application architecture. Suppose in Google Kubernetes or something like that, Docker thing, if I want, then I can redesign my application so that it will be very fast and scalable, easily available. Then rebuild on PaaS. I have to rebuild or rewrite the application on the new platform. I can choose any platform because I have my requirement with me. I need to redesign my application. So these are the ways. So why people are not, means reluctant, means public sector, that is the main reason. Because applications are running from so many years, they are very comfortable, they are in comfort zone. Why to disturb all this thing and doing all this migration approaches which I told, it takes tremendous effort actually. So it's not easy to simply adopt the legacy app on, but it can be done basically. So some use cases in public sector, already in government sector, this your energy efficiency services limited. They are doing this smart metering project. Already they are purchasing crores of this smart meter. By 21 or end of 2022, they will be putting this IoT smart meters at every home so that billing will be very dynamic on-demand electricity you can take. So many things will be available in that. All this thing is going to cloud. Then you must have listened about this NRC issue in Assam. All the data was available on the cloud. That's why no issue was there when it was downloaded. In 48 hours, millions of downloaded was done because it was on cloud. Then the Bhubaneswar Smart Cities city project is also in cloud. Maharashtra is the state which they are having a policy, cloud policy. They migrate so many applications, SAP application, mailing solution, everything on cloud. And this Maharashtra State Electricity and Transmission Limited has done this in just 2 days actually. They migrated all their traditional IT infrastructure to the cloud. Private cloud service provider. Then Andhra Pradesh State Skill Development Corporation is having. They are using AWS. Pune in Maharashtra, again, Pune Municipal Corporation is having 150 application on this government community cloud, GCC. Tamil Nadu Public Distribution System, they are handling 35K devices for the distribution in their state. And ESL, MSHTCL rights, of railway, then NHAI, this highway construction agency, they all have opted for their SAP HANA ERP system, which is very mission critical. All of these are on cloud. Then Stand Up India, Mudra Bank, Power Finance Corporation, Indian Railway, now you see this your IRCTC improvement, because there was no reason for when you logged in to the IRCTC website, then you would need to choose a from and destination, then this railway train list is coming out. So now all this thing is available on cloud, that's why it is coming very fast. Then from Bhopal, this is smart city control center is available, that is on cloud. And now it is being used for this COVID monitoring there. Then basic cloud services identified by government, that compute service will be available, because we cannot go directly to Amazon or Google or Azure in government sector. So government has through ministry, they have identified some services, compute service, this processor, storage type, operating system, network, it comes under compute service. Then storage services are defined, storage, then object storage, where you store photos, videos, file storage for file system. Database services are also defined. There are so many databases are available, but they have identified only Microsoft SQL, MySQL, Oracle, like in cloud, some TinyDB, WebDB, so many databases are available, MongoDB. And network services, content delivery network, virtual network, load balancer, VPN, firewall, security services, Active Directory is mostly used in government sector. Then for DDoS, denial of services, counter this attack, DDoS services are available, SSL certificates provision is there, and multi-factor authentication. This authentication where you don't need to rely on single login ID and password. Another factor comes into the picture, like OTP or something which you only know, your face recognition. This comes in the multi-factor authentication. So this kind of services you can buy from cloud services. So there is a marketplace like Amazon, government e-marketplace. So all the empaneled vendor will provide only this kind of services in that marketplace. It will be listed there. So these are the empaneled cloud service provider. Amazon Internet Services Private Limited. Amazon has taken initiative. Amazon is the only global cloud service provider which is empaneled by central government. And Bharat BSNL is having controllers data center. These are the name of agencies. Major is then ESDS, it's IBM, Microsoft, then NetMagic, Nextra, Tata Communication. You will not find Google here. So in public sector, you will not be available to avail the service of Google in this government community cloud deployment model. Actually, if you want to go for directly any service like Gmail you want to have, or Google Suite you want to have, or this Google Meet facility you want to have, that you can take it directly from the Google. But customized services, because Google don't give my service like Amazon and Microsoft are agreed for our government. Maybe in future Google will come. HP is there, CFE Technologies are. So these 13 empaneled agencies are there, which are providing cloud services, government community cloud services to the government, state department, district administration, and central government departments. So this is the security requirement of cloud service provider. Actually, government has so much time government has taken for giving clearance, audits were done to finalize this 13 vendor. So they are fulfilling all this thing, this global compliances like ISO 27001, 2013, which is a set of standardized requirement for an ISMS, Information Security Management System. So it is for approach for establishing, implementing, operating, monitoring, maintaining, and improving your infrastructure. This is the global standard. They are fulfilling it. Then it comes 27017 certification. It is the guideline for information security controls and provisions for cloud service providers. Then 27018 certification. This is again security techniques for some public identifiable information. Because some public data will also be available, so they should comply all this thing. Then ISO this 20001 certification details. It is again related to service management. Some SLAs they have to follow. Then this tier 3 uptime certification. Then compliance specific to India. Some more conditions have been imposed on these service providers. Data center must be within India. Google was not ready. I think Google is still making their data center in India, I think near Noida somewhere. Amazon is already having in Mumbai. So that compliance they were not able to fulfill. Then adherence to IT Act, they have to comply all our IT Act. Then all the security guidelines, this 13 government agency, Ministry of Information Technology, or Government of India, whatever they will issue, they need to comply. Already they have to give. Then their audit needs to be done on a regular basis. There is responsibility shared between government. When you go for cloud, you are giving a contract to service provider and then you are availing the services, but there are responsibility which must be shared between both of them. First thing is identity and access management is the responsibility of government department. Then ensuring the security of endpoints that are used to access cloud services, configuring operating system, network, firewall, then applying data and server-side encryption, reviewing and validating security incident monitoring. These all are job of the concerned government department or public sector unit. Then cloud service provider have to do the security of infrastructure component, physical hardware, then virtualization, hardening, it should be secure, whatever virtual machines are there. Then physical and logical network segmentation, perimeter security services, providing tools for backup, offering disaster recovery services. These are the responsibility of shared this cloud service provider. Now come to your mobile again. This is the question is coming to your mobile. When an enterprise migrates an application to the cloud as is without making any modification, what is this called? 10 seconds more. Okay, so when an enterprise migrates an application to the cloud as is without making any modification, what is this called? It's called simple rehosting. You are re-architect means you are redesigning the application. But in question I asked, without making any modification, I am not making any modification. I am just taking up whatever website I am hosting in my data center, in-house data center. I am copying it and I am putting in the cloud platform. So I'm just rehosting, you know, I'm changing the host. So it will be rehosting. Remove will not refactor. Remove totally you are removing. Re-architect is redesigning basically. Okay. So come to next. Which of the following components are cloud customers, not providers responsible for? Okay. So cloud customer will be responsible, not the provider. Which thing? Physical security, identity management, security of data, or disaster recovery? Okay, 5 seconds more. Okay, identity management. This is the correct, good one. So, identity management is basically you are controlling the access of your data residing on the cloud or application. Now, which users can access? So, you are managing the identity. This is your responsibility actually. This is not responsibility of service provider like Amazon or Google. They will not do this. They will do the physical security. They will secure your data. They will do the disaster recovery, but they will not manage your identities. Okay. So these are the opportunities in the public sector. Now I will move fast. Actually, already I think half an hour is left for schedule. So cloud opportunity in public sector. This is the overall picture. Means in our government sector, internet users are increasing day by day. Digital India. So many government services are coming online after this. COVID situation, so many services will become, because now the way of life will change for everybody. Then 5G new technologies will come up, IoT, so many IoT, like I told, man, this is IoT, they are going for even for your electricity meters, your spatial data, average person interaction is increasing daily from 300 to 4,800. Then so many startups and businesses are coming. All your the GST data is going on cloud, so zettabytes of data is there, data explosion kind of thing. So there is huge opportunity in the cloud in the government sector also, but still it is untapped. So this is for this reason this our government went for this NIC National Cloud Meghraj Government of India initiative. NIC is established in 1976, providing the services to government sector, G2G, to businesses, G2B citizens, and their employees also. So they are having their own Information Commission Technology Network, NIC Net, which is already connecting all the district administration, state government, central government departments, UTs. So this infrastructure is already there. Then Government of India started this Meghraj initiative. Is to accelerate the delivery of key services. The main focus was that these services should be available online to the our general public. If everything is on cloud, then this will ensure the optimum utilization of the infrastructure and speed up the development and deployment of e-government application. You can go to this website cloud.gov.in. All the details are available here about this Meghraj. Then this is the architecture of this. There are state data centers already available. NIC was already having so many data centers for some government services like revenue record or this registration of your house when you go buy some house, something like that. Electricity departments are also having. So national data centers already set up 4 numbers. 1,000 racks are there basically. So in Guwahati and Bhopal, NDC is yet to set up. Then 13 CSP, I already told, this cloud service provider are empaneled. So they will use this infrastructure to accelerate the delivery of e-services. So this is some rough diagram, means how these states and government departments are using it under the Ministry of Information Technology. Then this is the Indian progress, means how we move ahead with the cloud. This cloud first policy came in 2013, then NIC has launched this first national cloud. And 2016, I was also invited by ministry because their office was just near my head office, Delhi, when they were impaneling this 10 cloud service provider. They wanted to have some feedback about the policies related to this cloud service providers from public sector IT departments also. So that time I was involved when this only 10 CSPs were impaneled. Then 2017, this 3 additional CSPs impaneled. In 17, then this cloud management office was set up. Then onboarding of cloud packages, which I told ki what kind of different services has to be there on GM, that has been identified. And then cloud services bouquet is now available on the GM. So and any state government or state government and their department, they can go to this cloud.gov.in and they can purchase the cloud services from there. Then application of community cloud, all this applications on already they have hosted this HRMS application on the cloud. PM Kishan Nidhi, this Sakhi dashboard, this is for women empowerment. Then MSME portal is there. Central Economic Intelligence Bureau is having their application. Namami Gange project is running. National Ads Control Organization is running on the cloud. Department of Science, Armed Forces Medical portal is there. Some defense portal is also available on this government community cloud. So we discussed 3 cloud, now public, private and community. So when I'm talking about government sector, everything is on community cloud right now. Please come to your mobile once. Okay, so does Madhya Pradesh has any cloud policy? Okay, 5 seconds more. Madhya Pradesh, actually, when some state wants to implement any cloud implementation, they should come up with policies. Maharashtra has already done this thing. 3-4 state governments have done it. But maybe I'm wrong, but I have not heard anything about this Madhya Pradesh cloud policy. They are having some MAP IT running with 200-300 developers. That is a kind of society running under some ministry of MP. So that is the only thing which I know, and everything they are maintaining in-house right now. So I don't think there is any cloud policy available in the Madhya Pradesh. Then cloud in international public sector. If you go United States, UK, Australia, Singapore and Canada, this gives a picture of how they rolled out the cloud for their government services. US started in 2011, UK 2013, Australia in 14. Then Singapore, they don't have any policy, but they are using government cloud. Canada is having from 2017. So this gives just a picture. Okay, now this false sense of security, which is the main hurdle of public sector or government sector for adopting the cloud. There's a diffusion of innovation curve. Actually, whenever some new technology comes up, this graph, exactly, I don't know, Roger curve, it is called, maybe MBA people know better about this thing. Some new technology comes, then innovators are the first which adopt, but they are very less, 2.5%. Then early adopters are there, 13.5%. Early majority, 34%. So, but when this technology is getting old, then comes this late majority and laggard, 16%. When you see, you will find this government sector or public sector comes in this laggard zone, actually. So they don't adopt any new technology very fast. They wait and watch, actually, because they are comfortable with whatever they are having. So it takes time. So why not to adopt cloud? Why some sectors are adopting cloud? Why some are not adopting? When you ask the private sector, they will say it's agile. Immediately they can fulfill their customer requirement on demand anytime. Competitiveness, they want to take edge on their competitors, speed to market, then lower cost, they are saving money. Now they are moving from CapEx model to operational model, OpEx, their revenue is going on that. Then new services are available, new products are available, and less liability. Means they don't need to have liability of in-house IT infrastructure. So this is the reason as private sector likes the cloud. So they are the early adopter. But when you ask public sector, they will have their own reason. Means government sector will say, what about security of the data on the cloud? Then compliance means there sometimes it's not clear defined guidelines from the government for the public sector for going to the cloud. Then manpower and skill, they are not having. It is a very difficult thing for them to understand these new technologies and how to work on them. They don't want to come out from their comfort zone. Then risk, because things are unknown for them, so it is a risk. So every unknown thing is a risk. Then legacy apps, as I already told, this old software application, whatever they are having in the government department, that is the main hurdle. Then government data center, if they want to have their own. Already they are having, like NIC was already having so much of data center. So then data classification, different kind of data is available, and how it will migrate to the cloud, that is not clear to them. So this is how this reluctance come in the public sector, and see in the private sector why they move ahead with the cloud. So this clarify that thing about the adoption of cloud between public sector and private sector. Then again, when you elaborate all this thing regarding government sector, the policy is the first thing. If they work on policy, government agencies work on the policy only. If they have policy, then only they can move. So if they have proper cloud policy, then security and compliance are defined. Another issue comes is the procurement, how they will do the procurement. And there's a vendor lock-in. Vendor lock-in means if suppose you went for Google technologies, so you trained your manpower in Google technologies, Azure, everything. And later on, after 3-4 years, if you think you have to move to Amazon, then you have to start from scratch. So now you are stuck. That is called vendor lock-in, actually. Then skill and culture, means culture is not there for this innovation technology. Then broad adoption is within your organization. People are not adopting, they are comfortable with their legacy application or such kind of thing. Computing systems developed over a long period of time in different technology. That is always there. Then OS not supporting, it will happen when you are having old technologies with you. Application not supporting, like load balancing. Suppose you are having old application, you still you put in the cloud, but it is not having the framework for load balancing when the spike is there in the demand of your application. You are not managed, and ultimately your application is getting crashed. So such kind of thing will happen. Then hybrid requirement means they are having some old requirement, like AD Active Directory they are using, and now still they want to, after moving to the cloud, Active Directory should be working, and they don't want to go for this authentication methods available with the new technology. Such kind of things are the barrier for public sector. Then how they can make a journey to the cloud? Same thing which I already explained earlier. This development and testing is the first phase. They can start with all government sector agencies. They can start with development and testing their new application on cloud. It will help to skill them manpower, and then it will give exposure to their IT manpower. Then storage backup they can go. Then new apps, whatever new apps and mobile, they should go for cloud. They should deploy it on cloud directly. Then some business processes or line of business application which they want on for day-to-day business process, whatever they are doing, it should be mapped and implemented on cloud. Then ERP and this customer management system, CMS, it needs to be refreshed in 10 or 12, 15 years, whatever. So whenever this cycle is coming, they should go for in the cloud deployment. Analytics, you can't do it without cloud, basically. Analytics and AI, if you are going for that, it's very difficult in your in-house infrastructure or on-premises infrastructure. Data center migration, you can do. Whatever data center you are having, you can completely migrate as infrastructure as a service. Mission critical apps, it will come at last. Means mission critical, whatever sensitive data you are having for your business or for government, that will come last when you are comfortable with all the previous steps in the cloud. Then you can bring your own encryption for whatever sensitive data. Suppose your land revenue record, you have to put, or this public key, private key mechanism is available. Means you put the encrypted data on the cloud, and anybody can, with proper authentication, they can access it. So this is the journey for government sector if they want to adopt the cloud in future. So it's a case study. Like I'm telling case study from my company also only. So what happened? We are having this state-of-the-art video conference system. Already my 60, we are having 60, 70 plants all over India connected through wide area network, internal network. So we set up a huge video conference system from Polycom, hardware-based, where we have a conferencing room. Even we are having telepresence room where you can do the meeting, where it feels like you are doing meeting one-to-one live. It is having that much of good quality, actually. So we invested so much in that thing. So that is hardware-based. But if you talk about moving to cloud, just in February, say, so nobody would agree for that thing. We should go for cloud video conferencing like we are doing right now. So main concerns were same thing, security, reluctance to change, comfort, because everything is working fine like this. But what happened after this post-corona, because now you have to maintain social distancing, offices were closed. Suddenly, everybody now moved to this Microsoft team, and that is also right now free of cost available to us. So the change happened immediately. Earlier it was not possible, so many constraints were there, but due to some pandemic situation, everything has changed in the public sector. So this is just a mindset actually in the public sector for adopting the technology. This is one example. People are not want to leave. People don't want to leave their comfort zone. Whatever is running, let it run. So this is one case study. Then another is our data center. We are having a huge data center in Noida, and there is a disaster recovery center in Hyderabad of similar nature actually. So right now, still as major public sector enterprise in India, NTPC or ONGC, you will not find any example who have adopted the cloud technology. So we are moving ahead actually now. We have taken first step by migrating our disaster this recovery center. Disaster recovery as a service, we are taking disaster recovery as a service, DRAS. So it will be on public cloud with the virtual machines so that we can remove our Hyderabad disaster recovery data center and we can move to the cloud. So this will be the first exposure for NTPC for moving to cloud. So later on, as per feedback, then more services can be taken. So as I already told, a journey. So these are the journey basically. So the exposure will be there, and slowly things will move on to cloud. Because ultimately, cloud is the future. Most of the things are available because you will be getting rid of your huge IT infrastructure. Because public enterprises like NTPC or ONGC, they can have their own dedicated IT department. Their revenue is huge, but it is not easy for other enterprises which want to focus on their core business. Like I said, PFC has done, NHAI has done. But they don't want to put effort on their IT infrastructure. So what they did, they outsourced their IT infrastructure to the cloud provider. So this is the only reason big enterprises are still having traditional IT setup, and some small enterprises which want to focus on their core business, whatever they are doing, so they are shifting to the cloud. And it will be applicable similarly to the government department also. Because if government is managing their own IT department, so they will not be able to focus on this e-application or e-governance kind of thing. So opportunities in public sector is that new avenues are available. So new applications should be there on the cloud. Then IoT can only be IoT is not explored still, means so many avenues are available in the public sector, be it BHEL, ONGC or NTPC. So that thing is available. Data analytics, when IoT is there, then data analytics and ML and AI will come automatically into the picture. Then industrial safety, so many things can be done using cloud. These are the opportunities for university and startup. One thing is that fostering entrepreneurship by solving business problems of government and public sector enterprise. So if all university colleges try to solve the business problem of these government agencies or this public sector enterprises, then this can help fostering the entrepreneurship. Then encouraging collaboration with the university means whatever is being done in lab to transfer the knowledge from lab to practice, with provision of critical funding for talented faculty and students to pursue foundational research, will help enhance the business process of government department and public sector. So it will help to improve the e-government services if universities talented faculty and students come up with some ideas. So this is another opportunity, and it will generate the intellectual property also. Job opportunities here is the cloud architecture. Certifications are available with all cloud service provider. How to set up the cloud, network engineer. Networking is different than traditional IT infrastructure. App development is almost same. Then database management. Data analytics is a demanding field future. Then sales and marketing. These are the job opportunities in the cloud. Okay, so now I'm finishing my presentation here. So if you have any question, and if you want this PPT download, then you can get the copy here, tini.cc/rgpv1. So from here, you have to give the feedback of the session, and then a link will be available to download the PPT which I presented to you, that you can keep. So shall we start? If anybody has question, please ask.
Participants, you can unmute yourself and then ask the questions. Hello. If you have any question, you can ask by muting yourself. Anyone is having question?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, please.
Hello.
Yes, sir, please.
Yes, sir, I want to know about hybrid cloud.
Hybrid cloud is the combination. Actually, as such, it is not used. It is a very normally organization don't go for such requirement. It is very specific requirement when it comes into the picture. So what will happen when you must? I told three type of cloud model: public, private, and then this community cloud. So when you are having half of your infrastructure on any of this any of two, so then it will become hybrid. So for example, suppose what I am doing, I have a private cloud for my main data center where all my applications are residing, ERP and enterprise applications are running through main data center. That is in the private cloud. Only I have access for that thing. Now what I am doing, I am taking a disaster recovery center in the public cloud. Okay. So what will happen? Now I have created a hybrid model actually. Okay. So now this hybrid model will come into the picture. So that is very specific to requirement, and normally it doesn't happen. So it comes in the textbook. Hybrid cloud is there when you mix any of these two clouds. Okay. So am I clear?
Yes, sir. Sir, I have another question. That if we want to do research on big data analytics, then which cloud will be best for that?
Best, so I cannot say, because data analytics is a field in itself. You have to that's a complete curriculum. First, you need to understand that data analytics. Then you have to go for any technology, and they are means all these big cloud provider. If you go for Microsoft, Google, and your Amazon, they are having different technology stacks. So when you are having your basics clear about data analytics, then you can choose any of this platform for moving ahead. As such, there is no priority if this is good or that is good. It totally depend on you, which technology you are comfortable on working with. Okay.
Hello.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, how cloud load balancing is achieved, sir?
Cloud load balancing comes in two places. One is your network network load balancer. So what happens when you are going for infrastructure as a service, you are having multiple internet connections available, so that load balancer service is available. So that suppose one ISP internet connectivity is down, immediately it will switch to the available, or it is distributed on demand. Means it will distribute the load in both the ISPs or three ISPs, whatever ISPs you are having. So at the IS level, it will work like that. So it balances the load in the networking level. But when you come to this application level, so what happens? You are having application design like that. Sometimes it's called Docker. You must be knowing in cloud. Docker is there, where you wrap up your application in such a manner so that you can scale your application as per demand. Means your application will be scaled. There will be Docker engines available. So suppose there is huge demand or spike for your application, then it will replicate your application in many folds, and it will cater the need. So according to the demand, they will this Docker engine will fulfill the will load the will balance the load actually. So these are the load balancing actually in the cloud. That's why it is very useful.
Thank you, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, you were talking about collaboration with university. So how can we avail of that? I am a professor in a college in Mumbai. So whom to approach?
Approach means it can be done only by the top. As far as I know, from the top management of both the parties. Basically, if some government agencies are there nearby your university, then head of that government agency and means head of your management, they can do some MOU solve some day-to-day problem of their department. So these initiatives will come from actually both the parties, actually, not from third person.
Okay. Any particular government department which is more approachable then?
Yes, it depends. And it depends on the management also. The person who is heading that department, actually, if he is very tech savvy and interested, then obviously he will not deny, because ultimately it is going to benefit his services to the public. Actually,
okay. Okay.
It depends. Some south states you will find so many things happen because that side management is like that only.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Sir, what are the security threats in cloud computing, sir?
Security? I'm not getting. Please repeat.
Security threats. Security attacks.
Okay, security threat is always there. Even in your in-house IT infrastructure, security depends on your financial status, basically how much investment you want to do for security, because nothing is secure. Okay, so now you have to decide what type of data you want to put. You have to do the risk analysis, basically. There will always be a risk analysis in your organization when you are putting data anywhere. Even if it is in-house, some earthquake can come and everything can go. If you don't have any disaster to back up, or there is fire in your building, so there are multiple kind of security threats. Cyber threats is also considered. So risk assessment needs to be done, and accordingly you have to check your financial model, how you are going to invest in the security. So nothing is secure, basically. So security, but in case of cloud, when you go see if you are having a data center in your university or in your organization, you are not having a technology expert. But when you are talking about this Google or Amazon or Microsoft Azure, they are having a PhD holder and expert security engineers. They are working in a control room around the clock, and they are monitoring each and every traffic and data. So in this terms, it is highly secure. And you compare like that, because your local data center is not having that much of security, only it is physically isolated. Okay, for Aadhaar, it was told once in a time in the Supreme Court, our Aadhaar data is in 13 feet high wall and 5 feet thick wall, something like that. So that is false sense of security. So if you think security in terms of this, so it's quite secure, basically. Ultimately, everything is going on cloud. You are using Gmail or something like that from so many years. What kind of security threat you have faced? Another thing which comes is privacy or advertisement. It is not related to security, because you are using that service for free from Facebook or Google. So they are analyzing your data and serving you ads as per your consent, actually. Still, it is your data is secure everywhere, but just they are analyzing your habits, what you are doing, as per that they are serving you ads, actually. Still it is secure. You are using the service for free. But when I am paying for a cloud service provider, I am paying a huge amount, and then I am going for an agreement with them. We made an agreement for security of my data. So he has to comply that thing, because we are in agreement. Okay.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, we are not able to download the PPT, sir, the link which you have given.
Okay, I will give it to coordinator so that they will mail to everybody.
Sir, can we have your email ID, sir?
No, I will forward it to coordinators. They will send it to everyone who are registered, I think. It would be better.
Any more questions from participants?
I think, sir, there is no question now. Thank you, Vinod, sir. It was very, very wonderful session, and definitely all will get benefit of it. And I think we will share the PPT as you provide us to all the participants who have registered in this event. Thank you, sir, once again. Very, very thank you for giving your time from your busy schedule. Thank you, sir.